So, welcome to part 7 of the lecture on competing reactions. Subject of today are stereoelectronic effects. These effects have always something to do with orbital interactions and the geometry of those interactions. And one general rule within polar reactions is that the orbitals which interact should have similar energy level. Well, for instance, the Diels Alder reaction. Homo-Lumo interaction with within the Diels Alder reaction, you need an electron-rich electron-rich diene and an electron-poor dienophile, as you remember. And Homo-Lumo is in this case rather similar. So you certainly know those schemes. Energy, and we have the HOMO of molecule 1, fully occupied, and on the other hand, we have the LUMO of molecule 2. Those will interact and will form a bond with one bonding orbital, and there will be an anti-bonding orbital. And we gain energy since the bonding electrons will be finally on an energy level that is significantly lower than in the starting highest occupied molecular orbital. So, if those two energy levels are similar, then we have an optimum in interaction. In addition, the size of the interacting orbitals should also be similar, that we get a maximum in overlap. Let's see. A carbonyl group here, we have the sigma bond plus a pi bond, the pi bond by the overlap of two p orbitals of similar size, since in both cases, it's a 2p orbital. So, gives a nice and strong bond. Let's compare this with a thioketone. Here, we have the overlap of a 2p orbital of a carbon and a 3p orbital of a sulfur. So let's visualize that 1p orbital and a bigger p orbital from the sulfur. That does not fit as well as here in this case. Therefore, the carbon-sulfur double bond is weaker compared to a carbon-oxygen double bond. When HOMO and LUMO get together, they should approach each other on the closest, on the most simple trajectory, reaching a maximum on orbital overlap on a shortest way. Well, okay, this might be disturbed by some electrostatic interactions. We know that from the Bürgi-Dunitz trajectory. Well, within the Bürgi-Dunitz angle is the result of the optimum trajectory. There is stereoelectronic component and there is some electrostatic repulsion between the free electron pairs of the carbonyl group and the electron pair of the nucleophilic agent that is attacking the positively charged carbon. So, some interesting effects that results from those stereoelectronic interactions. One is the so-called anomeric effect. Originally, the anomeric effect has, of course, something to do with sugar chemistry. You know the anomers, which are stereoisomers, diastereoisomers within sugar chemistry, where those that only are distinguished by the stereo center at the hemiacetal functionality. So, let's see. Methoxycyclohexene with the methoxy group at an equatorial position is favored compared to the conformer with the methoxy group in axial position. The reason simply is the 1,3 steric diaxial interaction here. Here we have repulsion. Therefore, this one is favored. But let us just change this CH2 group against an oxa functionality. So here we have an acetal. And now the equatorial position of the methoxy group is disfavored compared to the methoxy group in axially, an axial position. So there must be an effect which overcompensates this 1,3 diaxial interaction. What could be the reason? It was much debate. Well, there is some repulsion because of the high electron density within this conformation, repulsion between the free electron pairs. In addition, the dipole moment, so the dipoles here, it's dipole interaction, dipole-dipole interaction, which results in repulsion, because here the dipoles of that part and that part is approximately in line. But there is an additional factor, orbital interactions. So, let's have a look here in this scheme. We have the free electron pair here in this sp3 orbital. For the methoxy group, we have here parallel the antibonding, empty orbital, the empty antibonding orbital of the carbon-oxygen bond. And these are collinear and can interact. So, some electron density flows from here to there. Making this bond stronger and that bond somewhat weaker. But overall, having the energetic effect that this is favored. Similarly, chlorocyclohexane, here with the chlorine in equatorial position, is favored compared to the one with the chloride in axial position. So, going from here to there, we need to invest 0.55 kcal per mole. On the other hand, so this is endothermic. With the additional oxo functionality, the anomeric effect favors this isomer, this conformer, with the chloride in axial position, overcompensating the 1,3 diaxial interaction, as I already said. And we gain 2.17 kcal per mole. This is quite a significant amount of energy. let's come to the so-called gauge effect. Also very interesting. We have a look at those examples of a gauge effect making use of Newman projections. And it is now about difluoroethane, 1,2 difluoroethane, and its preferred conformer. Here, with both fluorides in an antiperiplanar position, and now a comparison with the gauge conformer. And the gauge conformer is clearly favored. Why? Again, an orbital interaction of the antibonding orbital of the carbon fluoride bond with the bonding orbital of the CH bond. The CH bond delivers some electron density into the antibonding orbital of the carbon fluoride bond. Remember, that part of a molecule is highly electrophilic due to the fluoride. But on the other hand, a carbon fluoride bond does not want to deliver any electron density into the antibonding bond of the other CF. Okay? So, and from the geometry, it's always the same. Well, just as with the anomeric effect, but let us draw that again. So, here, the fluoride, one hydrogen, the other one. Here we have the fluoride in front, the hydrogen here, antiperiplanar to the fluoride, another hydrogen there. So, and that means here we have the antibonding orbital of the carbon fluoride bond, and on that side the bonding part of the CH bond, and here, well, this is located parallel. And an overlap can take place in this case. More gauge effects. Preferred conformation within ethylamine. Here we have the free electron pair of the amine could be located antiperiplanar to the methyl group, but, oh no, not but, it is favored, somewhat favored, compared to that conformer that has a CH bond antiperiplanar to that free electron pair. So why is this somewhat preferred to that one? In both cases, the hyperconjugation, it's a hyperconjugation of a free electron pair with the antibonding orbital could take place in both cases, but the carbon is a bit more electrophilic than compared to the hydrogen. That's one main reason. And another nice example for a gauche effect: hydrogen one could think that the antiperiplanar position of the two free electron pairs could be the optimum, since that high electron density is far away from each other as possible. But in reality, it was found that a gauche conformer is preferred. Why? Here, from here to there, and from here to that CH bond is the possibility of a hyperconjugation with the antibonding molecular orbital. Here in this case, there is no antibonding MO in antiperiplanar position. And this overcompensates the repulsion through negative electron density. Let's have a look at such stereoelectronic effects or orbital interactions within cations. So let's see. having, for instance, a carbocation here with an empty p orbital, then a full non-bonding orbital, well, this is a free electron pair, can of course interact. For instance, having a nitrogen here, amino group, a free electron pair, then we have an iminium cation. But also, having a sigma bond here, also in this case, from a sigma bond, there can be electron density delivered through orbital interaction with that p orbital. So here, this is non-bonding, and that's also a p orbital. Examples for that. The protonation of isobutene. This is then the tertiary butyl cation. And here we have then the interaction of the bonding orbital of a CH bond with that empty p orbital, and the same with other CH bonds which are collinear in that case. And indeed, you can measure this interaction because, well, an interaction here will strengthen that CC bond. And meanwhile, we of course have crystal structure analyses of those tertiary butyl salts. And as it turned out, that bond length here is at 1.44 angstrom. For those who have forgotten the typical bond length of carbon-carbon bonds, well, okay, a normal CC bond, both sp3, is estimated, or normal, with 155 picometers. Okay, let's change here also then to 144 picometers. A CC double bond of an olefin, 134 picometers. That means that the CC bond in a tertiary butyl cation is from the bond length right in between a CC single and a CC double bond. Just to be complete, benzene aromatic system, 140 picometers. So that means in benzene, the CC bonds are still a bit stronger compared to the tertiary butyl cation. And those who visited the lecture on stoichiometric or organometallics might remember the beta effect in silicon chemistry. So, having an allyl silane and an electrophile E plus attacking, then we will always have the carbocation beta to the silicon. Resulting in this overall transformation. Well, for instance, please remember the Sakurai reaction as one example. So, maybe just adding here good donors. CH bonds, carbon-silicon bonds, carbon-tin bonds. Bad donors would be CN, so nitrogen here, CO, and for instance, carbon with a chloride sitting there, simply because all those elements are highly electrophilic. Well, for fluoride, it's even worse. Okay. More effects. So, let's have a look at this cis olefin. And what about the interaction of orbitals? Let's see. Here, we have the CH bond. On the other hand, we would here have the antibonding molecular orbital of that CH bond and an interaction. Well, they are not in line. On the other hand, if we would have it trans, then let's see. Bonding orbital, and here on the other side, the antibonding part of that CH bond, then we have, well, the orbitals rather in close proximity and in line. So here, an interaction might take place. Here, there is an interaction, but far less compared to that one. So, and we can indeed measure these interactions having a look at the coupling constants in NMR spectroscopy. And as you know, the coupling constant in cis olefins between those hydrogens, let's see, you can observe that if R and the second R prime are different, is clearly smaller compared to the trans coupling. Here we are about, well, 10 hertz, 8 to 10 hertz, and here maybe 12 to 14 or 15, approximately. Effects on reactivity. A trimethyl ammonium salt. We can skip the anion, it doesn't play any role here. This one treated with well, let's say we have a chloride, and here we have the potassium t-butoxide. What will happen? Thinking about an elimination reaction done in tertiary butanol at 75 degrees. I hope you remember, for an elimination reaction, it's usually a trans elimination. Well, there are cis eliminations with xanthogenates and so on. You remember that? The typical elimination is a trans elimination with an antiplanar position of the leaving parts of a molecule. The hydrogen and the leaving group. Okay, so, but with the nitrogen, this ammonium functionality in an equatorial position, there is no adjacent beta hydrogen which is antiperiplanar. What we need in that case would be this conformer. Having that ammonium group in an axial position, and in this case, in the same time, also the tertibutyl group would get into an axial position. It doesn't want to. And therefore, an elimination doesn't take place, but a nucleophilic substitution with the nitrogen as leaving group. So, percent of this amine is formed, and well, as a result, it's clear that MTBE should be the byproduct. On the other hand, having it already in the axial position, since the tertiary, this is the stereo isomer. Here we have the cis isomer, there the trans isomer of that. These are not conformers, these are isomers. Okay? Now this is rather stable with the ammonium in axial position, since the other conformer, then the tertibutyl group would have to adopt the axial position. Okay? Here we now have antiperiplanar located CH bonds, and here then the elimination is preferred leading with 90% yield to this olefin, and on the other hand the demethylation of the ammonium group accounts for the other 10%. So, what is the influence of that tertiary butyl group? Well, I've already explained that, but the proof is trying the same reaction with the ammonium salt with the missing tertiary butyl group. In that case, we have about 7% of cyclohexene and 93% of that demethylated tertiary amine. So, the tertiary butyl group here prevents the formation of those 7% elimination product. Fragmentation reactions. So here, an alcoholate, we have a donor. And a methoxy group in equatorial position. So that alkoxylate delivers electron density. There is an electron pressure on that CC bond. And since this CC bond is approximately in line with that equatorial located methoxy group, there is the hyperconjugation of the bonding orbital of that with the antibonding molecular orbital of that possible. And that means here this reaction can take place. And would lead to the macrocycle, and this has been indeed tested with such an spiroacetal present. Another fragmentation that works very well is this one. So within this bicyclic system, we have here that free electron pair, and there we have the chloride for the fragmentation like this. This bond has to be broken, and that bond. Okay? So, here, that free electron pair is in line with the antibonding molecular orbital of that CC bond. This can nicely donate electron density into the antibonding molecular orbital. thus strengthening that bond and at the same time weakening that CC bond. Okay, so like that, resulting in this structure. On the other hand, so this easily fragmentates, therefore, a tosylate leaving group here, and an amino functionality there. So, a fragmentation one could think of is like that. Well, this doesn't occur. On the first glimpse, it is similar to what we have discussed before. But look here, this is in an axial position. That CC bond to be broken is in an equatorial position. The overlap doesn't work in this case. So, also an important stereoelectronic effect here. Finally, for today, I would introduce a nice example within a fascinating natural product synthesis done by Michael Perung. I think that was done on his own account as he was 23 or 24 years old and published that by himself. It is Perung's isocomine synthesis. Highly interesting by itself, and there are also some stereoelectronic effects one should discuss there. Okay, so isocomine, let's draw the target compound. Oh no. This tricyclic system. And for the synthesis, it started with this compound. First, a methylation, just LDA and THF methyl iodide 81%. So where? Here it is deprotonated for the enolate and then C-methylated. Okay, next step. Addition of a Grignard reagent well, as usual, in an ether, in that case, THF first, and then secondly, hydrolysis, HCl, H2O, acidic workup. Isolating a product with 90% yield. So, what will happen? The Grignard nucleophile will attack that carbonyl group, forming the tertiary alcohol. Upon hydrolysis, that alcohol will be a leaving group and will be eliminated, and that part of a molecule hydrolyzed. So that means we get to a ketone here, have the double bond there, here one methyl group, there the other, and here comes the side chain. As this, 90% yield. That side chain has been introduced since now there is that olefin here and a photocycloaddition can take place with irradiating with light 350 nanometers. Two plus two cycloaddition process. And as it turned out, racemic, but as a single diastereoisomer. This one. So I hope you already notice the general idea of that synthesis. By the way, 77% is quite good. The general idea is here we have a 5-membered, a 4-membered, and a 6-membered ring. Here, 5-membered, 5-membered, 5-membered ring. Ring enlargement of a 4-membered ring. And at the same time, making the 6-membered one carbon smaller. Then we should have the three annulated 5-membered rings. Okay. Prerung tried quite a few experiments until he found that, well, was in need of an additional carbon, and a Wittig reaction in dimethyl sulfoxide did the job, a Wittig methylation. Also, 77% yield gave 11. Okay. This is obviously our key intermediate. So, and please, as an exercise, think how could you get from here to the target molecule. Which reaction conditions and by which mechanism? Please have a try. So, once again, we are right now at this stage. Within that synthesis, and we try to achieve that transformation . So, clearly, here, this part remains the same, and the four-membered ring is enlarged, and the six-membered ring will become smaller to a five-membered ring, so a ring contraction. Well, and clearly, there has to take place a rearrangement of a carbon framework. For ring contraction, you should know Favorsky rearrangement. And, well, a Wagner-Meerwein rearrangement could make this larger and contract that one. So, this bond has to migrate from here through there, Wagner-Meerwein. And how can we activate for a Wagner-Meerwein? We have to get a carbocation here just by a protonation. So, paratoluene sulfonic acid, heating that a bit up, here in benzene, we will get to this cation, and now, in the sense of a Wagner-Meerwein rearrangement, we would achieve that ring contraction and the ring enlargement on the other side. And now we just have to deprotonate here. And it's done. And it worked with an astonishing 98% yield. Well, we could be satisfied with the reaction and, of course, with the explanation. Simple as this. But we have learned about stereoelectronic effects. What about the orbital interactions during this step? So let me draw this intermediate from another perspective. Let's say we have here that four-membered ring. There, this methyl group. This is the annihilated five-membered ring. And then the six-membered ring. Like this. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay. There's one additional methyl group here. Right. So, and let us draw the empty p orbital of this carbon. So, Wagner-Merwein rearrangement. Let's say this is the C-C single bond A within the four-membered ring. Now the electron density from here should go in there. What about the overlap of the electron density of that molecular orbital bonding molecular orbital with that? It looks like it's almost perpendicular. Okay, on the other hand, B seems to be in line. Okay, let me tell you, there is a big difference between paper chemistry or blackboard chemistry, visualization here, and putting that carbocation into a computer with molecular modeling. I did that this morning, okay? And this drawing is a bit misleading. Actually, at least with a semi-empirical calculation, that orbital axis vector goes like this. And we then have a dihedral angle, okay? And the dihedral angle between the bond B and this orbital, this p orbital axis vector is 51 degree, and here is it 55 degrees. So it's more close to that one according to the calculation than to the other one. That's not completely there and should not be completely on that side. And now is the big riddle. If for that calculations there should not be a 100% selectivity for the migration of A or for the migration of B, how come that we achieve, or Perung achieved, a 98% yield? This is the big riddle. Hope we can clarify that. One additional experimental result. What about protonating this one? So, okay, on the stage of that carbonyl compound. Let us protonate this at the carbonyl group. Then we get this stabilized carbocation. Well, and again, either A or B could migrate for the skeletal rearrangement, and in this case, two products were isolated, and I draw these structures as they were shown in Perung's publication. ...75% of this structure and 75% isolated, the minor one, but more close to the isocomine final product was this one with 15% yield. So I think now it's interesting and should be the next step to figure out the mechanism leading to that and that structure, and how the mechanism here is related to the formation of this product. Similarities and differences between the mechanisms. So, I know these are complicated structures, therefore we will simplify and just having a look at what happens with this partial structure. in this part the music is playing, okay? So, and X could be oxygen or CH2 group. And the rearrangement is initiated by the protonation. Okay, carbocation here. Now, let us assume we have here CC bond A and there the CC bond B. Let us assume that A is migrating. From here to there, this means we would get those two annihilated five-membered rings. With the methyl group or OH group sitting here, there we would get the carbocation. If X is an oxygen having an OH group here, then we have the special case that very easily a second skeletal rearrangement step could take place. Please remember, this should remind us of a pinacol-pinacolone rearrangement. Imagine here a leaving group is gone, OH group. Okay, how could the pinacolone be formed? Letting this bond migrate to this position is just the retro reaction. That doesn't make sense. Okay, but we have another carbon located here, and this one could migrate. So, what does this mean? So, OH group puts in electron density, this one migrates, and in this case, we should then get to this structure. I hope you notice the similarity to that one. On the other hand, let us migrate B. B, of course, does not migrate behind the methyl group in front. Oh, you see this one here. I think here is a methyl group missing, right? Here should be an additional methyl group there. Right, okay. So, and it's migrating from here to there. It means in front. Okay, so if this goes from here to there, then we have the carbocation with the added methyl group in principle behind the blackboard. But if we try to rotate that in our mind, then this should be the result. So, yeah, this should be right. Okay. Now, the next step. Again, pinacolone rearrangement here. This one, putting in electron density, and that these electrons going there. So in the sense of a pinacolone rearrangement. This then means I'm going to draw that as similar to that structure as possible. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Okay. Right. So, and let us draw this by another perspective. We have two five-membered rings annihilated. At the bridgehead is that methyl group, and here at the beta carbon there is that XH here. Okay, and there the cationic charge. And now to the solution of the riddle. From here, to that one, it's easy, for X is oxygen, it's just minus H plus. from here to that elephant. It's also easy in the case X is CH group, it's again minus minus H plus. But have a look at this structure and have a look at that structure. For X is CH2, those two structures are all the same. So, it actually doesn't matter. Do you go into that rearrangement with the bond A or the bond B? In both cases, it's at the end the same result. This explains the 98% yield you have. And trust me, I tried it. Also, if you add all the other structural elements, additional methyl groups, you could later on do that. Having that ring here, then there. Here it should be on that other side, okay? Adding the additional five-membered ring and the methyl group, it makes the drawing more complicated. Yeah. But you will notice at the end, okay, this and that is the same if X is CH2. Okay, I think this is enough for today. Thanks for listening. We go on next week, Tuesday, with, well, I think something about stability of molecules and reactivity in general. Okay, see you next week.